In this segment, we'll talk about that many times you might be asked to do polynomial regression, but you would not know beforehand what kind of order of polynomial regression to use. So we would like to use a polynomial which is optimum nature. It's not too high, it's not too low. Not too high that it defeats the whole purpose of doing regression in the first place. And we don't want it to be too low that it doesn't really capture what the data is trying to tell us. What we're going to do is we're going to answer this question: what polynomial model should we choose if one needs to be chosen? And we're going to do it through an example. So here is a typical example given to us, where we're given thermal expansion coefficient as a function of temperature, and there are 22 data points given to us. So if 22 data points are given to us, that would make us believe that we can use a polynomial order 21 or less to go through those 22 data points. So the question is that, hey, what order of polynomial, which will be 21 order or less, should we be using for regressing to this particular data which is given to us? So for example, if we go ahead and take these 22 data points, and here what I have done is that I have taken a first order polynomial and regressed to that, and that's the straight line which we get, which explains that particular data. Now, what I do is I take a second order polynomial and regress it to the 22 data points, and this is the kind of curve I get. Now, visually, this might seem to be appealing, but what stops us from going to a third order polynomial or a fourth order polynomial and say, hey, that might be a better model to choose? So we want to be able to make that decision not based on looking at our curves visually, although that can be one of the checks, but also to be able to do this scientifically. Let's go and see how we can go about doing that. If you look at these two graphs, keep in mind that these two graphs are exactly the same. They are drawn as a function of the order of the polynomial. This particular left graph which you're seeing here starts with m equal to 1, and this right graph here starts with m equal to 2. So I just want to make that clear right in the beginning so that you guys don't think that these two are two separate separate graphs. So they're exactly the same graph. However, the starting point on this one is m equal to 1, which is right here, and the starting point on this one here is 2. So what we are plotting here is the sum of the square of the residuals as a function of the order of the polynomial. We know that we have 22 data points, and we can take a first order polynomial, a second order, a third order, and so on and so forth, all the way up to the 21st order polynomial to do the regression. And as we can see that, if we look at this particular graph, which starts from m equal to 2, mainly to illustrate that at 21, when I choose 21st order polynomial, which will use all the data points, that means that it will pass through all the data points, I should say, and in that case SR will be exactly equal to 0. So for m equal to 21, SR is equal to 0, and for any other value of m which is less than 21, the sum of the square of the residuals will not be equal to 0. So if we use that, hey, if we use the criterion to choose the optimum polynomial to be, hey, let's pick up a polynomial for which the sum of the square of the residuals is as small as possible, you'll find out that the polynomial which goes through all the data points would be the optimum one to use. And we really very well know that that's not regression. We are trying to simplify, to explain the data by a simple model. And here we're going to take 22 data points and make it go through a 21st order polynomial. So there should be some mechanism of choosing an optimum polynomial. Let's go and see what we do in that case. So here, again, I want to make sure that you understand that both of these graphs are exactly the same. This one starts with m equal to 1, and this starts with m equal to 2. That's the only difference which I'm showing you. So the left one starts at m equal to 1. The right graph starts at m equal to 2. So the two graphs are the same. However, what we are plotting here is this quantity called SR divided by n minus m minus 1, which can be also written as SR divided by n minus m plus 1. So that's what we are plotting. We are plotting this quantity here. We're taking the sum of the square of the residuals and dividing it by the difference between the number of data points that you have and the number of constants we have in the polynomial model, because if it is a mth order polynomial, it has m plus one constants. Like a first order polynomial has two constants, a second order polynomial has three constants, and that's where this m plus one is coming from. What you're going to find out is that this numerator here, which is the SR, decreases as a function of m. It goes down as m increases. So does n minus m plus 1 right here. This one also goes down as m increases. You can see that if n is constant, because it's the number of data points, as we keep on increasing m, this particular quantity is going to decrease as m increases. The same is the case here, that the sum of the square of the residuals is going to decrease as m increases. So what you're basically doing is you are making the two, the denominator and the numerator, compete against each other to be able to choose that optimum polynomial order which you want to choose. So here what we are finding out for this particular example, we are finding out that, hey, maybe m equal to 2 seems to be enough, because after m equal to 2, what happens is that the sum of this particular quantity right here, which is the sum of the square of the residuals divided by n minus m minus 1, turns out to be not having a big change after that. And we're not necessarily looking for an optimum, for a minimum value of this quantity right here, because we would expect that this quantity will do something like this, and this is the optimum polynomial m which we'll choose. But that's not necessarily going to happen all the time. In this case here, it is continually decreasing, but as you see, that after 2, the values for 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, for example, are of the same order for all of these quantities right here, for this particular quantity which is right here. So the same order. So why not stop at 2 in order to be able to say, hey, that's the optimum order of polynomial to use. And that's the end of this segment.